Welcome to our worship service this morning. We're glad that those who are here live have joined us live this morning, our first Sunday back. It's so good to see the brave folks are here. So we're glad that you're here worshiping with us. And for those who are still watching via live stream, we welcome you as well. We're glad to be able to share with you in this new way. And my name, for those who may be new watching on live stream and our guests here, my name is Pastor Doug Batinger. And we are happy to be able to share this morning. This morning we're going to be talking about this new experience that we're having, this new normal. And we've been told not to call it that because we don't know what's yet to be. So we're actually going to be looking at and thinking about what it means to be living in the wilderness. These are wilderness times for us. And so our new sermon series will be taking a look at living in the wilderness. I will mention, for those who are watching at home, we will continue to have someone help us to sing our songs, and Nancy Overton is here to do that as well. And a thanks to John Fuchs and the trustees for preparing these plexiglass shields so that I can speak without a mask and you can hear me more clearly. And we can worship together in that way and sing safely with the screen as well. So we look forward to this hour together, and we invite you to use this time now to prepare your hearts for worship as we share in the time of our prelude. Let us pray. God of hope, as we've gathered this morning, we lift our praise to you as we draw together in your presence. Bless this time of worship as we center ourselves on your faithfulness to us. Be our place of refuge on this journey in the wilderness that we find ourselves in. Help us to find a center. Help us to find your presence and know your presence as we worship and praise this morning. So we bring you our hearts, we bring you our minds, we bring you our souls as we worship this morning. Accept the offerings of our lives in Jesus' name. Amen. Our opening hymn this morning is number 698, God of Our Fathers. You'll find the words in the hymnal, or they're also on the screen. And for those who are here, we invite you to stand as we sing together, and at home, sing with us as well. Thank you. Please be seated. Thank you, Nancy, for helping us to sing. We normally would invite the children here to join us for our brown bag time, but I think the children are still at home. We have some spots set out here for in case we did have anybody come, so we could do this safely. But I'm still going to take a moment to talk to the children. And so if you're watching at home, please gather the children to the TV or the device that you're using as we share together. I wanted to talk this morning about this what happened yesterday. For those of you who are at home, you know that it's the 4th of July was yesterday. And when I was growing up, the 4th of July, we always called it the 4th of July without really thinking about what it actually is called, which is, as you know, Independence Day. And it's a day that we celebrate that we received freedom from England back in 1776 when we declared ourselves a free country and able to govern ourselves and to, you know, be on our own. And I wanted to take just some time this morning to think about what that means for us as a country. Today we, you know, we turn on the news and we hear a lot of different things. We see, you know, protests, and we see people arguing about face masks and discussing what's, you know, should we wear face masks, should we not wear face masks? What, you know, does it help, does it not help? And we talk about statues being torn down, and we see a lot of things that sometimes are disturbing to us. We may not really understand fully what's going on, and it seems like our country is in a lot of turmoil. And while that may be the case, I can tell you that growing up in my 57 years, there have been times when things have been quiet, and there have been times when things have been kind of in turmoil. But what I want us to think about this morning is Independence Day and what that really means for us. We are a country that, because we have the freedoms that we have, can gather for worship. We can gather freely this morning for the first time in months without fear of having anybody come in and tell us, oh, you can't do that. You can watch at home and be a part of our service at home, and we can share our service through Facebook and through, you know, Zoom, or other churches use Zoom, others use other means of you know, broadcasting their service. And we can do that and not worry about having people listen to us and say, oh, you can't say that, or you can't do that. We have freedoms in this country, and as difficult as things are right now, with the virus and with the unrest that we see and all the things that we may see on the news, as hard as it is sometimes to think that things are okay, we live in a great country. And so what I would just encourage all of us to do, whether you're children or adults as well, take some time to give thanks to God for the freedom that we have, for as imperfect as it is, because we're all human and none of us are perfect, as imperfect as it is, we live in a country where we have a lot of freedoms, and that's something to be thankful for. So take some time this weekend, whether it's today or sometime during the week, just to say thank you to God for the freedoms that we have in our country, for the country that we live in. It's not perfect, but it certainly is a place that we can enjoy and know that we can grow and live and share our faith with others and to give thanks to God for all of God's blessings. So take some time to remember what this weekend, this yesterday, and all the fireworks and things that had all the dogs and cats upset, you know, in the neighborhoods, what that was all about. And it was to celebrate and to give thanks for what we enjoy as a nation. So I hope you'll take some time to do that. Let's have a word of prayer together. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the opportunity we've had to celebrate this country that we live in. And we know that it's not perfect. We know that we are led by men and women who make mistakes, just as we all do. But we thank you for what our country stands for. We thank you for the freedom that we have to gather and to gather without fear, to lift up your name in praise, and to know that we can worship you and that we can proclaim your love to others without fear. And so we thank you for men and women who have made that possible through the years, whether it's through serving and maintaining the freedoms that we have, or whether it's through defending our country in the military, for all the ways in which you've helped folks provide that for us, we are grateful. And so help us to remember that you are our source. You are where we find our freedom, and we thank you for your love. In Jesus' name, amen. So this morning we want to take some time to share with you some special music. We are using music that has been pre-recorded through the week, And this morning, our special music comes to us from the Stanton family, and we look forward to hearing their offering and song this morning. From Amy, just I think it was yesterday or maybe the day before, and she said, "I just want you to know the special music was is going to be us on Sunday, and the song that we're sharing is based on Micah 6, chapter 6, verse 8." And you know, I thought about what I was going to share during the brown bag, and if you, I'm sure this is a familiar verse to you, but Micah 6, 8. Says, "He has told you, immortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God?" And I thought, boy, God has, again, a way of putting together a worship service. We sometimes hear special music or choir selections that just fit with what the theme is or what we're thinking about. And I thought, well, God, there you go, it's happened again. And so thank you, Amy and Abby, for supplementing our brown bag time with your special music this morning. We want to take a moment to lift up our prayer requests. We have several that I want to share with you. We are not using our prayer book, as you notice. Again, trying to limit touch and contact with things. But I'm wondering, is there anybody this morning that has any prayer requests that's here live that they want to share? Marie, I have yours. I'll mention that. So I did get yours. Okay. So that's how we're going to do it. So if you do have one that you'd like to share, please, you know, feel free to, you can let us know that way, or tell me ahead of time, as Maria did. And so Maria's request, Maria and Nick are here, and they're going to be moving very shortly. An unexpected move, as their house that they're in is being put up for sale. They're going to be moving to Mullica Hill. And so Maria asked for prayers for their entire family as they go through this. If you've ever moved, you know how much fun that can be, and that's sarcasm. If you can see that through the plexiglass, it's not fun to move. It's a lot of work and difficulty, and especially when it's unexpected. So please keep the craze in your prayers as they go through this move. We also want to pray for Pearl Dickinson, who is having difficulty with her leg, and also Viola Yeager, Viola Yeager's family. Viola was visiting in Florida, and there were a lot of family members experiencing some health concerns, so we lift up the Yeager family this morning. We also want to pray for two folks that the Dickels lifted up. One is Carol Herkner, and the other Lisa Cavanaugh, both who have serious health concerns. And also from our church, we want to lift up Janet Fuhrer. Janet has been diagnosed with cancer. One of her biopsies came back positive. And so she's going to be having a bone scan very soon. For more information, so please keep Janet Fuhrer in your prayers. We also want to pray for Todd Hickman. Todd has been experiencing some further seizure and memory issues, so please keep Todd and his entire family in your prayers. And then also we want to remember, many of you know Drew Burris, who has been singing with our choir for special times and has been providing special music through the summers occasionally. Drew is the husband of our district superintendent, Myrna Bethke, and you remember that Myrna, we were praying for Myrna 2 weeks ago, who she suffered a stroke. And we received word on Friday night. Actually, Drew called me and was looking for some assistance, and Myrna passed away. And so many of you remember Myrna. She would share with us occasionally in worship. She would show up for Vacation Bible School and our block party and special events that we were having here, and of course for the cantatas when Drew was singing. And so Myrna will be deeply missed, although our loss is heaven's gain. And so we know that Myrna is not struggling with health. She never regained her consciousness after her stroke. And she was also experiencing some seizures that were causing more damage. And so she went home to be with the Lord on Friday evening. So please keep the Drew Burris and family in your prayers. Pray for the churches of our district, the pastors. Many of us, Myrna was more than just a district superintendent. She was a friend. And so we'll miss her presence. So please keep all of us in your prayers. Let's take a moment to lift up these requests this morning as we share together in our time of prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for these moments that we have to come into your presence this morning. We come to you as imperfect people, as people not worthy to enter your presence, and yet in your grace and your mercy you receive us and you allow us to come and to share our needs, our concerns, all the things that we deal with. And so help us as we come this morning to focus on how we can rely more on you. So many times we try to go through difficulties and handle these needs on our own without realizing the source of strength that we have in your presence. So as we gather this morning, we ask that you would help us to know your shelter, your strength. Help us always to lean upon your faithfulness to us. And so it's in that assurance this morning that we come to once again give you thanks for our country and for your faithfulness to all of us. Help us again to lift up and to celebrate the freedoms that we have in you. We pray for your faithfulness to be made known in the lives of these persons that we've mentioned this morning. For those who are dealing with health concerns, many different kinds, we just ask for your healing presence and your touch. And for the assurance that you are there. This morning, too, we lift up the Cray family as they are going to be moving, and for the turmoil that that can cause, and we just ask that you would allow that transition to go smoothly for them, and just let them remind them that when they move from one place to another, they don't move out of your presence. And we pray especially this morning for Drew and for all of Myrna's family, for our district, for churches, for pastors. We give you thanks for Myrna's life and for the way she shared her faith and love with us as she was with us for the 6 years as our district superintendent. We thank you for her faith and are grateful that she has now been victorious and entered your presence. But for the vacancy and for the loss that leaves, the churches of our district and the pastors and all those who that you come, that we can come to you and lift up these needs that we have. And we continue to pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So once again this morning, for those who you heard that noise, just a word of what that is. That's our, we have some fans that help to circulate the air. So when you hear that, just know that that's moving the air for us so we can have some fresh air come in and again, gather safely for worship. We thank those of you who have made your offering this morning. Just a reminder for those who are here, if you have your offering with us, there is an offering plate by the door. And we invite you to leave your offering in the offering plate. Again, we thank you for those who have sent offerings in through the electronic giving and through the mail. We are grateful for that as well. Just a word about next Sunday. Our hope is to be able to celebrate communion next week. We are waiting for our new communion elements that are on back order. So we're waiting for them to come in. We're hoping they'll be here for next Sunday. And we thought maybe it would be better to wait till next Sunday after we got 1 week under our belts coming back together anyway. But our communion offering next week will be used for our traditional July communion offering is for Vacation Bible School, which normally has taken place by now. Again, this is all new for us. So we're working our way through, but our communion offering will be used for whatever the mission project is for Vacation Bible School that we hope to have in August. So, and if for some reason we're unable to have Vacation Bible School, we'll keep that offering for the next time we do have Bible School and use it for that mission offering. And so next Sunday we'll be receiving our special mission offering for Bible School during communion. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks once again for all of your blessings. And as we work our way through these different times, we just ask again for your blessing. We thank you for the ways in which our church has been blessed through the gifts that have been given. And we pray that as you bless our offerings, they will be used to be a blessing to others. We thank you for the opportunity that we have to reach out and to serve and to help those who are in need and to proclaim your love and salvation in so many different ways. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning is from Numbers chapter 14, verses 1 through 24. Then all the congregation raised a loud cry, and the people wept that night. And all the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron. The whole congregation said to them, "Would that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would that we had died in this wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword? Our wives and our little ones will become booty. Would it not be better for us to go back to Egypt?" So they said to one another, "Let us choose a captain and go back to Egypt." Then Moses and Aaron fell on their faces before all the assembly of the congregation of the Israelites. And Joshua, son of Nun, and Caleb, son of Jephunneh, who were among those who had spied out the land, tore their clothes and said to all the congregation of the Israelites, "The land that we went through as spies is exceedingly good land. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will bring us into this land and give it to us, a land that flows with milk and honey. Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not fear the people of the land, for they are no more than bread for us. Their protection is removed from them, and the Lord is with us. Do not fear them." But the whole congregation threatened to stone them. Then the glory of the Lord appeared at the tent of meeting to all the Israelites. And the Lord said to Moses, "How long will this people despise me, and how long will they refuse to believe in me, in spite of all the signs that I have done among them? I will strike them with pestilence and disinherit them, and I will make of you a nation greater and mightier than they." But Moses said to the Lord, "Then the Egyptians will hear of it, for in your might you brought up this people from among them, and they will tell the inhabitants of this land. They have heard that you, O Lord, are in the midst of this people. For you, O Lord, are seen face to face, and your cloud stands over them, and you go in front of them in a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. Now, if you kill this people all at one time, then the nations who have heard about you will say, 'It is because the Lord was not able to bring this people into the land he swore to give them, that he has slaughtered them in the wilderness.' And now, therefore, let the power of the Lord be great in the way that you promised when you spoke, saying, 'The Lord is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, forgiving iniquity and transgression, but by no means clearing the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the parents upon the children to the third and fourth generation. Forgive the iniquity of this people according to the greatness of your steadfast love, just as you have pardoned this people from Egypt, even until now.' Then the Lord said, 'I do forgive, just as you have asked. Nevertheless, as I live and as all the earth shall be filled with the glory of the Lord, none of the people who have seen my glory and the signs that I did in Egypt and in the wilderness and yet have tested me these 10 times and have not obeyed my voice shall see the land that I swore to give to their ancestors. None of those who despised me shall see it. But my servant Caleb, because he has a different spirit and has followed me wholeheartedly, I will bring into the land into which he went, and his descendants shall possess it. Now since the Amalekites and the Canaanites live in the valleys, turn tomorrow and set out for the wilderness by the way to the Red Sea.' This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." So this morning, as we begin our series, I want to take just a moment to talk about what we'll be looking at in our sermon series. As I've said, we've heard, you know, so many people tell us we have to live in this new normal. It's a new way of living. And certainly, you know, as we have regathered this morning, we kind of understand that things are not as they were. I don't know if I would call it a new normal just yet, but it's our new reality, at least, of the way in which we're living. And so we're going to be talking about what it means to live in the wilderness. What does it mean to be in this place of wilderness that we find ourselves in during these days of uncertainty, these days of not knowing what tomorrow will bring? And we'll be looking at some of the experiences of the wilderness for the Israelites and for the folks in the Bible who experienced that wilderness, much like we're experiencing it now. So that's this morning we're going to be beginning our series thinking about that. Certainly, as you scroll through Facebook, If you're on Facebook and are a person who looks at Facebook, you can find just about every emotion tied to what it is that we're going through. If you look far enough, you can find frustration. There are people who are frustrated with, you know, having to wear masks, and when we were being kept at home, we were frustrated about not being able to go out and see people and do the things that we normally do. I know one of the things that was frustrating for Pam was when school ended abruptly in March, she was not able to say, you know, goodbye to the students that you worked with in the school because things changed that quickly. And so it was frustrating. And you can see that. You can find people on Facebook and different forms of social media who are afraid. There still is fear. And when you talk to people, as you see the spikes of the virus in different parts of our country, there are people who are afraid that, you know, it's going to come back, or do we gather for worship? Can we do that safely? How do we do that? And many are afraid to do that. There's anger. People are angry about it. Why do we have to go through this? You know, this was not started by, didn't begin in our country. It started somewhere else. And you know, why do we have to do this? This isn't, it's not fair. And we're angry about it. Other people feel helpless. You know, well, it's nothing I can do about it. You know, I can't change things. This is just, and there's a sense that, you know, if I could do something to change it, I would, but I can't. Other people feel uncertainty. You know, what's tomorrow hold? Is it going to be like this forever? Is it going to, will there be a vaccine? What's going to happen? Some of the unrest that we see, where will that lead? There's mistrust. Who's telling the truth? You know, all kinds of conspiracies out there. If you're into that kind of thing, you can find it. And honestly, sometimes they're fun to read, but they make you wonder. There's doubt that, you know, is God really with us in this? I mean, what's happened? Have we been abandoned? Is this, where is God? For some, there's relief that, you know, okay, finally we can get back together to worship. We can come to church. We can begin to do some things that we couldn't do. So there's the sense that, you know, okay, it's beginning to feel okay. But for all of us, regardless of what we might be thinking and feeling along those lines, for all of us, I think that we can all agree it seems like that we're living in a strange land. Nothing is as it was before. This is all new. It's all different. And we certainly aren't used to it yet. I have to tell you a funny story from last Sunday, even. And, you know, I can kind of confess that this was, it's one of those things where you just kind of go, oh, you know, what was I thinking? We did our scholarship presentation. We did that ahead of time. We recorded it, and then we decided to just do the graduation recognitions live last Sunday outside on the steps of the narthex. And you know, I thought, oh, wouldn't it be nice to hear from some of the graduates, like what they are looking forward to, for those who are continuing their education, what those who are, you know, finishing education, what they'll be doing. And so I said, well, let's go out there and we'll gather in the parking lot. We'll do it safely. We thought through everything. And I said, I'll take the handheld mic out and, you know, ask them that so that the people who are watching at home could hear it. And so we did. We talked to all the graduates and I, you know, asked them questions, and they held the mic and I presented them their gift. And the service ended and I came back in, and Roy, who was back there on the soundboard this morning, said, you know, we probably should have put up a microphone stand. And me, you know, still oblivious, said, well, yeah, because it was kind of hard. I didn't think about having to hand gifts and get the microphone and juggle gifts and microphone. He goes, no, not that. He said, they were all touching the microphone. And I was like, oh my goodness, you're absolutely right. And never even thought about that, you know, so it's all new, it's all different. We're not used to it. Even no matter how much we think through and think that we've got this, at least for me, I find myself, oh, really? Yeah, how could you forget that? Or how could you not think of that? And so the very fact that this morning I'm preaching on a text from the book of Numbers tells you that things are not normal. I don't think I've ever preached from Numbers before. This is a first. So here we are in this strange place, this strange wilderness. And as we think about the book of Numbers, it's a book about the people of Israel, It's a book written when they were wandering in the wilderness, when they were in between times from being released from Egypt and entering the land of promise that, God had promised for them. In fact, if you, look up what the name of the book, Numbers, which Numbers in English, if you look up the Hebrew word that's translated as Numbers, it literally means in the wilderness. And so it's a book written about their experience as they wandered through the desert, 40 years of wandering in circles. And Numbers as a book really has no beginning and no ending. It's kind of a circular book that just kind of wanders around as you read it. It's not the most interesting read in the world, but it nevertheless is a recording of what the people were going through. And Numbers is a book that's written about this in-between time. It reminds us that as people of God, as people who follow faithfully and try to follow faithfully, as people of God, we can expect to have these wilderness times, these strange times, these in-between times. What we once knew is gone. What will be is yet to be seen. And so here we are in the midst of this. But even in the midst of the wilderness, in the middle of the wilderness, in the midst of what the people of Israel were dealing with, there was something that helped them through all of it. And that's really what I was to think about this morning and focus on this morning. It's something that helped them through, and it's pointed out to us in the very beginning of the book. If you look at Numbers 1:1, it says this. It says, "The Lord spoke to Moses in the wilderness of Sinai, in the tent of meeting on the first day of the second month in the second year, after they had come out of the land of Egypt." And so as the people were wandering, it was the tent of meeting, the tabernacle that God had given them, that grounded them. It was the thing that God had instructed them to build so they could put it up very easily and take it down very easily, with very detailed instructions on how to build it so they could do that, that God gave them that as a symbol and sign of his presence with them. And so as the people wandered through the wilderness, the tabernacle, this tent of meeting, was the place where they were able to find stability, they were able to find focus, and they were able to survive all of these wanderings. Now, our text this morning that I read, Numbers 14, takes place right after Moses sent spies into the land of promise. If you remember that story, they wandered for the 40 years, and they finally got to the place where they were going to enter this land that God said that he was going to give them. And so Moses sends spies in to check it out. What is it that they're going to find when they go into this land that God is going to give them? And so they went into the land and they found bunches of grapes that were so large that it took two people to carry them. They had to tie them to a pole and carry them, between two people. It was just like God had promised. They found blessing, they found food, they found, grapes and milk and honey and all the things that God had promised they would find there. But they said, there's a problem. There's all this good stuff, but the people who live there are giants. They're huge. And there's no way that we can defeat them. There's no way that we can go into this land and take it from them. So, how is God going to give us this land when we can't defeat them? We're like nobody compared to them. And so the people hear this report of the spies and they begin to complain. Why didn't you leave us in Egypt? We should have died there. Maybe we should die in the wilderness, because that's going to be better than going into that land and being killed by these people that are giants, being defeated by them. And they felt that their lives were out of control. And what they wanted to do was to go back to Egypt. Let's go back to what we knew. Let's go back to where there was some sense of control. Let's go back to at least we knew we were alive. It wasn't the greatest, but it was okay. And they wanted to go back, even if it meant walking away from the future that God had promised. Now think about that. God said, I'm going to be with you. You're my people. I'm not going to desert you. I'm going to be with you. I'm going to give you this land. This land is yours. It's going to be a land of promise. It's a land of blessing. It'll be a land where you find everything that you need. And they were willing to throw that away and say, let's go back to slavery. Let's go back to captivity where we had no rights, no freedoms, because we don't know what we're going to find when we enter that land of giants. Today, I think as we are faced with what it is that we're facing, the uncertainty that we deal with, the, the question of tomorrow, we are faced with those same wilderness days, with the desire to go back to what we knew, to walk away from the future that God promises. We look at the challenges that may lie ahead, and we wonder what life will look like in the gathered community. What challenges will we face as we try to be faithful, as we try to share God's love? How will we do vacation Bible school? Can we do vacation Bible school? Is that even going to work this year? What about the block party? What about all these things that, why can't we just go back to the way things were? How will we ever safely have the choir here again to sing? How will they ever practice so that they can sing safely? There's challenges in that unknown for all of us. In some ways, it seems like giants. It seems like there's giants in the land ahead that we can't possibly overcome all these things that we're dealing with. We become so focused on the challenge and difficulty of what lies ahead that we miss the huge bunches of grapes. We want to go back to the good old days. We want to go back to those times, whatever that might mean for us. And we imagine that there's some preferred way of living in the past, that things were better back then. And as we struggle to find our way back to that, we feel like we're wandering aimlessly or walking in circles, because we're missing out on the promise that God is with us, that God will bless us, and that God's promises are faithful. But then look at what happens. Moses and Aaron and Joshua and Caleb all say, if the Lord is pleased with us, he's going to bring us into that land and give it to us. Look what he's done for us so far. Look how faithful he's been. And if he says that's going to be our land, then that's going to be our land. We don't have to know how that's going to happen. Don't rebel, because the Lord is with us. And then, of course, the people wanted to stone them. You know, listen to you guys. They picked up stones ready to let them have it. And that's when the glory of the Lord appears at the tabernacle, the tent of meeting. It says that God's glory was made known. God's glory shows up. God shows up and says, all right, I'm done. I've had enough of these people. They're faithless. They won't listen. 10 times I've grumbled, and 10 times I've answered their complaints. And I'm done. But Moses says, God, wait a minute. You know, you gave me these people. I'm in charge of these people. You've been faithful. You're a God of love. You're a God of forgiveness. Don't do that. And Moses intercedes and prays for them, and asks God to forgive and not to wipe out. And at the end, those who forgot God's promises, they do miss out on them because of their lack of faith. But those who remembered, those who trusted God, those who were looking forward to God's future, were rewarded. They entered the land of promise, if you fast forward, and it became theirs. Friends, this morning, we can't afford to have amnesia about the promises of God. No matter how frightening the wilderness is, no matter how uncertain days may be, this is not our home. Our future is in the land that God has promised us. That place of new creation that someday we'll enter, where we'll live in God's presence forever, and there will be no more sorrow, no more pain, no more coronavirus, no more uncertainty, no more doubt, no more fear, because we'll live in the very presence of God. And so, how do we survive in the meantime? How do we find our way in this wilderness? How do we stay faithful? Whatever it is that this wilderness has taken from you, whatever it is that you feel robbed of, and indeed all of us have experienced that. There's things that we've had to give up, things that we miss. Whatever it is that's been taken from us, we can recover it in the tent of meeting. We can recover it when God's glory shows up and we're reminded of God's faithfulness. The tent of meeting is that place that grounds us and helps us remember God's promises and experience God's presence. And so for those who have gathered here this morning, it's this place of familiarity, this place where we hear the music, we see the stained glass windows, we look at the altar and we reflect on God's faithfulness in the past, and we can center ourselves, and all of that stuff that seems uncertain, we can put it aside for just a few moments and gather who we are as people of God. It's in this place that we experience God's presence and promise and are reminded of how God is faithful. In a few weeks, we're going to have the opportunity to gather outside. We're going to be led in worship by our praise band, the Eons, our worship team, the Eons. And they'll be helping us. And we're going to do that outside on July 26th and the 23rd. And so there's been a lot of ways in which we're trying to make this the place where people can gather and find that presence in the center. So, for example, Nick and Blaze Colomarino helping with the lawn, and Walt Rue helping with the lawn. And Ed and Joyce Westcott were outside the other day planting flowers. If you look at the little garden outside the narthex door there's new flowers there and around the side and mulch. And they're working to make this a place where it becomes the tent of meeting, where we can meet God and see God. But it's more than that. It's not just here on Sunday morning. We have to find that tent of meeting for ourselves every day. Yes, it's great to come to church, to worship, and to be in this place that seems so familiar. And for those who are at home, at least to hear and see the familiarity as much as possible from home. But we have to find that tent of meeting for us every day. What is it that helps you focus? Where is it that you find God's presence in your life? Where do you find that grounding, that place that renews your faith, that gives you energy and helps you through the challenges of the day? Find it and go there and set aside time every day to be reminded of God's faithfulness, God's promises. Find a way every day to express gratitude to God for what God will do for us, what we know lies ahead, that we won't be deserted and left in the wilderness. And share that with at least one other person. Find somebody that you can say, you know, God's been faithful to me in so many ways. And share some of that. Spend some time in the tent of meeting each day. I'm going to be sharing with you some scriptures on our Facebook page after worship this morning. And I'll be doing that each week of the sermon series to use each day as a tent of meeting place, a place to look at God's word, to read, to spend some time thinking about God's promises. So I'll be posting that on our Facebook page, and our Facebook page is public, so anybody can find it. Just look for the United Methodist Church of Mantua. And those scriptures will be listed there. And I invite you to just read sometime during the day one of that scripture for the day, and take some time to think about God's presence. And then Wednesday of this week, there's going to be an opportunity to check in with everybody at 7 o'clock. I'll be sending out a Zoom link for Wednesday evening, just to chat, just to see how people are doing, to talk about the wilderness, help us to find our way through that. And so we invite you to be a part of that as well. But we give thanks to God for God's promises, for God's faithfulness, for us to know that as we face these days of uncertainty, that we have a tent of meeting where we can meet our God and be reminded that God's promises will be fulfilled. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for these stories in Scripture again that took place so long ago, and yet we find in them our own reality. And so as your people, remind us of how you have been faithful to us in the past, and that when we want to go back, we risk missing out on what you have for us tomorrow. So keep us focused on the days ahead. Help us to know that whatever it is that you promised will be fulfilled. We haven't been let down before by you, and so we shouldn't expect that that will happen anytime sooner. So we thank you for your love. We thank you for your promises. We thank you for your presence that guides us. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So our closing hymn this morning is number 580. And as Nancy comes to help us to sing, we invite you to stand. And I should have said, I apologize again, that here's the new normal, the things that you forget, that you just kind of take for granted. If you're here this morning, we do invite you to sing quietly. You're probably going to do that with face masks anyway. It's hard to sing with face masks. Or hum along, but follow the words on the screen and reflect on God's goodness as we worship together. Go forth to proclaim the good news. God is with us. Then come together again, gather again, so that we might join in the centering power of Jesus' love. Let the Holy Spirit guide you in the journey ahead. And may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.